From San Francisco, this is Democracy Now!
Today, let me be clear. North Carolina is taking Hurricane Florence seriously. And you should, too. Get ready now.
More than 1.5 million people are being evacuated from the Carolinas and Virginia as a Category 4 hurricane threatens the region. We'll speak with climate scientist Michael Mann about how climate change is supercharging hurricanes. Then, President Trump's National Security Advisor John Bolton attacks the International Criminal Court for probing possible U.S. war crimes in Afghanistan and Israeli war crimes in the occupied territories.
We will let the ICC die on its own. After all, for all intents and purposes, the ICC is already dead to us.
We'll speak with Jamil Dacquar of the American Civil Liberties Union. Then superstar Serena Williams calls out sexism in tennis after she's repeatedly penalized in the U.S. Open finals by a male umpire.
And for me to say thief and for him to take a game, it made me feel like it was a sexist remark. I mean, like, how he's never took a game from a man because they said thief. For me, it blows my mind.
We'll speak with Penn State professor Amira Rose Davis. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Trump's National Security Advisor John Bolton threatens sanctions against International Criminal Court judges if they proceed with an investigation into alleged war crimes committed by U.S. troops in Afghanistan.
We will ban its judges and prosecutors from entering the United States. We will sanction their funds in the U.S. financial system, and we will prosecute them in the U.S. criminal system. We will do the same for any company or state that assists an ICC investigation of Americans.
As National Security Advisor John Bolton speaking during a speech to the Federalist Society in Washington, D.C. Monday. Bolton also announced the Trump administration's closing the Palestine Liberation Organization office in Washington, D.C. The PLO called the move a dangerous escalation, saying it shows, quote, the U.S. is willing to disband the international system in order to protect Israeli crimes and attacks against the land and people of Palestine, as well as against peace and security in the rest of our region, unquote. We'll have more on John Bolton's speech later in the broadcast. The enormous Category 4 Hurricane Florence is barreling toward the East Coast, with 1.5 million people across Virginia, North Carolina, and South Carolina facing evacuation orders. The National Hurricane Center is warning of widespread flooding and a possible life-threatening storm surge. This is North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper.
The forecast places North Carolina in the bullseye of Hurricane Florence. And the storm is rapidly getting stronger. When weather forecasters tell us life-threatening, we know that it is serious.
We'll have more on Hurricane Florence and the links between hurricanes and climate change after headlines. The Trump administration's planning to make it easier for oil and gas companies to pollute the atmosphere with methane gas, one of the most powerful greenhouse gases contributing to climate change. The Trump administration could announce the rollback of the Obama-era rules requiring companies to monitor and repair methane leaks on oil and gas wells as early as this week. In more climate change news, California Governor Jerry Brown has signed a new law to shift California to 100% carbon-free electricity by 2045.
There's no understating the importance of this measure. SB 100 is sending a message to California and to the world that we're going to meet the Paris Agreement and we're going to continue down that path to transition our economy to zero emission, zero carbon emission, and to have the resiliency and the sustainability that science tells us we must achieve.
That was California Governor Jerry Brown speaking Monday ahead of the Global Climate Action Summit here in San Francisco. We'll be broadcasting from San Francisco throughout the week. Meanwhile, United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres warned Monday of the risks of runaway climate change, calling on world leaders to take dramatic steps to limit greenhouse gas emissions within the next 2 years.
Climate change is the defining issue of our time, and we are at a defining moment. We face a direct existential threat. Climate change is moving faster than we are, and its speed has provoked a sonic boom SOS across our world. If we do not change course by 2020, we risk missing the point where we can avoid runaway climate change with disastrous consequences for people and all the natural systems that sustain us.
And 350.org co-founder Bill McKibb announced Monday more than $6 trillion of endowments and portfolios have now been divested from fossil fuel companies. The new target by 2020, he says, is $10 trillion divested from fossil fuel companies. On Monday, New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio and London Mayor Sadiq Khan published a joint op-ed in The Guardian calling on other cities around the world to divest their assets, writing, quote, "We believe that ending institutional investment in companies that extract fossil fuels and contribute directly to climate change can help send a very powerful message that renewables and low-carbon options are the future," unquote. The Washington Post reports 1,600 federal workers have left the Environmental Protection Agency since President Trump took office, a mass exodus that has shrunk the EPA's workforce to levels not seen since the Reagan administration. Among the EPA workers to depart the agency was scientist Ann Williamson, who left the EPA after 33 years, saying, quote, "I did not want to any longer be any part of this administration's nonsense." A top United Nations official is warning an all-out Syrian government ground offensive against Idlib province, the last major rebel-held territory in Syria, could lead to the worst loss of life in the 21st century.
There needs to be ways of dealing with this problem that don't turn the next few months in Idlib into the worst humanitarian catastrophe with the biggest loss of life of the 21st century. You know, we had the tsunami in 2004, which killed 250,000 people, roughly. We had the atrocious famine in Somalia in 2011, which killed another 250,000 people. We must, it's not acceptable to have huge loss of life in Idlib over the next period.
In Afghanistan, at least 20 people have been killed in a suicide bombing in the eastern province of Nangarhar. No group has claimed responsibility for the attack so far. The White House says it's preparing for a second possible meeting between President Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un after Trump received a very warm, very positive letter from Kim requesting another meeting. Trump and Kim met for a summit in Singapore in June, marking the first time a U.S. president has met with a North Korean leader. Meanwhile, South Korean President Moon Jae-in is slated to hold his third summit with Kim next week as the two leaders continue discussing plans to formally end the 1950-53 Korean War. In migration news, Doctors Without Borders says more than 100 people died earlier this month when their boats shipwrecked off the coast of Libya en route to Europe. Among the victims were at least 20 children, including babies. The United Nations says at least 1,000 people have drowned in the Mediterranean so far this year trying to reach Europe. Back in the United States in Texas, more than 100 people rallied outside the Dallas police headquarters Monday night to protest the police killing of 26-year-old Botham John. White Dallas police officer Amber Geiger killed John, a black man, in his own apartment after she walked in allegedly believing it was her apartment. The two lived in the same apartment complex. Officer Geiger has been charged with manslaughter. In Florida, Republican Congressmember Ron DeSantis has announced he's immediately resigning from Congress in order to focus on his gubernatorial campaign. DeSantis is in a tight race against Democratic Tallahassee Mayor Andrew Gillum, who is vying to be the first African-American governor in Florida's history. DeSantis's resignation from Congress comes as the Washington Post has revealed he's spoken four times at a conservative conference where far-right speakers regularly spout Islamophobic, xenophobic, and racist views. Other recent speakers at the annual David Horowitz Freedom Center Restoration Weekend conference include President Trump's former chief strategist Stephen Bannon and white supremacist Milo Yiannopoulos. And federal prosecutors have admitted they wrongly accused Russian gun rights activist Maria Butina of trading sex for influence with high-level Republicans. The Justice Department has charged Butina with acting as an unregistered agent of the Russian government and accused her of trying to infiltrate the NRA and other right-wing groups. But the prosecutors now admit they mistakenly interpreted a joking text exchange between her and her longtime friend, who took Butina's car for an inspection and then texted her, quote, "I don't know what you owe me for insurance." Butina jokingly answered, "Sex, thank you so much." Prosecutors now admit this exchange does not prove she was trading sex as part of a secret Russian government effort to infiltrate high-level Republican circles. On Monday, a federal judge ruled Butina must stay in jail after her trial because she's a flight risk. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We begin today's show with Hurricane Florence. More than 1.5 million people have been ordered to evacuate the coasts of Virginia, North Carolina, and the entire South Carolina coast as the enormous Category 4 storm continues to gain strength. The hurricane is barreling towards the East Coast, bringing with it heavy rains and high winds that could linger for days after hitting land. People up and down the coast are preparing for extreme flooding and what the National Hurricane Center is calling a life-threatening storm surge. It's projected to make landfall on Thursday or Friday. And experts are warning the damage could be catastrophic. This is North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper.
Forecast places North Carolina in the bullseye of Hurricane Florence. And the storm is rapidly getting stronger. When weather forecasters tell us life-threatening, we know that it is serious. North Carolina faces three threats here. First, the ocean surge along our coast, then the strong winds, which may be higher than the other hurricanes that we have recently experienced, and of course, inland flooding from heavy rains. And we here in North Carolina are bracing for a hard hit.
Hurricane Florence has grown more powerful due to unusually high sea surface temperatures in the Atlantic linked to climate change. Warmer temperatures also mean more moisture, which scientists say could lead to more extreme rainfall and flooding. For more, we're going to Pennsylvania to speak with Michael Mann, distinguished professor and director of the Earth System Science Center at Penn State University. His latest book, co-authored with political cartoonist Tom Tolles, is titled The Madhouse Effect: How Climate Change Denial is Threatening Our Planet, Destroying Our Politics, and Driving Us Crazy. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Professor Mann. Talk about the significance of Hurricane Florence and why you believe it links directly to climate change.
Yeah, thanks, Amy. It's good to be with you. So as you heard the governor say earlier, this hurricane is a triple threat. It poses a great risk in terms of the storm surge and the coastal flooding that is likely to come with that. It's going to be packing powerful winds. Right now, it's a Category 4 storm. It could potentially strengthen to a Category 5 storm, so very damaging winds. And perhaps most significant of all, it's predicted to stall when it makes landfall. And so that will lead to very large amounts of rainfall, flooding rainfall, perhaps rivaling what we saw with Hurricane Harvey last year, which was the worst flooding event on record. Now, climate change is playing a role with each of those threats. Sea level rise, already a foot of sea level rise in that region, adding to the storm surge. A warmer atmosphere holds more moisture, so you get more rainfall. And a warmer ocean has more energy to strengthen these storms. And part of the problem with storms like Florence and with Harvey last year is that they have intensified very rapidly. When you get those very warm ocean waters, which are near record levels right now off the U.S. East Coast, you get very rapid intensification, faster often than the models predict. And so suddenly you're scrambling to deal with a Cat 4 monster storm that you didn't expect.
So talk about the lingering of this storm. Right now, it's Category 4. Expected it may gain strength to Category 5. What it means when it lingers in an area, the inundation the land, the people will experience.
Yeah, that's right. So again, if we look at Harvey last year, what made that storm so devastating, again, a record flooding event, the worst flooding event on record in the United States in history. What made it a record flooding event was the fact that that storm stalled. It didn't move on. So it's sitting over the same location, in that case, Houston, dumping rain day after day after day. Florence is predicted to do the same thing over the east coast of the U.S., the southeast coast and the interior sort of portions of South Carolina up into Virginia, potentially up even into Pennsylvania, the state that I live in. Now, one of the other more subtle potential impacts of climate change is this sort of behavior. Storms like Harvey and now with Florence tending to stall, tending to stay in the same place day after day, which is what makes them such record-soaking events. We think that there's a linkage with how climate change is influencing the jet stream. It's influencing the jet stream in a way that sort of pushes it further north in the summer and into the fall so that it's unable to pick up those storms and carry them out to sea, which the jet stream would normally do. And that has to do with an expanding region of high pressure in the subtropics. Climate models were used to predict that particular climate change feature decades ago. And we're seeing it happen, and it's having an impact even on the effect of storms like Florence.
And explain more what the jet stream is, Professor Mann.
Yeah, so the jet stream is this band of very strong winds that blow from west to east above the surface of the Earth. It's the reason that the flight from the west coast to the east coast is so much quicker than the flight in the opposite direction, because you've got those very strong tailwinds aloft. And those same strong winds aloft literally move weather systems along from west to east. But when the jet stream gets pushed up north, as it is right now, and that is, again, a very robust feature of the projections of climate models, that the jet stream tends to get moved further north, it's unable to move those storm systems like Florence from west to east out to sea. It appears that this particular phenomenon played a role not just with Florence, but with many of the extreme weather events we saw this summer. They were tied to a very highly meandering jet stream, a wiggling jet stream, bringing unusual weather around the entire northern hemisphere, and a slow jet stream so that that weather stays locked in place and you get epic droughts, epic wildfires, and in this case, with Florence, potentially an epic flooding event.
Let me ask you about this latest news. The Trump administration planning to make it easier for oil and gas companies to pollute the atmosphere with methane gas, one of the most powerful greenhouse gases contributing to climate change. The administration could announce the rollback of these Obama-era rules requiring companies to monitor and repair methane leaks on oil and gas wells as early as this week. The significance of this.
Yeah, so this is just the latest assault by the Trump administration on basic environmental protections that have been put in place over decades by Republican as well as Democratic administrations. And in this case, by allowing polluters to release more methane into the atmosphere, as you allude to, methane is an even more potent greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. Now, it exists in much lower concentrations, and it doesn't hang around for as long. But if we release enough methane into the atmosphere over the next decade or so, that could boost the warming that we see. And, you know, at the end of a summer now where we have seen unprecedented extreme weather events that signify how climate change isn't a far-off threat, it's impacting us now, today, where we live, at a time when the impacts of climate change are so obvious that not even the most fervent climate change denier can deny that they're there. We see efforts by the Trump administration to roll back the very very policies, regulation of carbon emissions, regulation of methane emissions in this case, that have the potential to stave off dangerous warming, that have the potential to help us meet our obligation to the Paris Agreement so that we do avoid catastrophic warming of the planet. So this is just the latest assault by the Trump administration on global efforts and efforts here in the United States to avert catastrophic climate change.
And this latest news that at this point, something like 1,600 federal workers have left the EPA. 1,600 scientists leaving in droves. The significance of this.
Yeah, well, this administration doesn't like what the scientists are telling them. This administration is basically a mouthpiece for polluting interests. And so they have basically used every avenue available to them, again, to roll back basic environmental protections, to intimidate government scientists, to prevent them from doing their work, prevent them from talking to the public and informing our public discourse. So this is, again, part of this assault by the current administration and enabling congressional Republicans on our efforts as a society to try to confront the greatest challenge that we face, human-caused climate change. Here's the good news. As you know, we have a midterm election now in just a matter of 60 or so days. We have an opportunity to send a signal that we want to be part of the larger solution to this problem. We don't want to be the problem itself. And if people don't like the fact that the current administration and congressional Republicans are doing everything they can to scuttle global efforts to tackle the climate change problem, they can turn out at the midterm election and make their voice heard at the voting booth.
And on more climate change news, we're here in San Francisco. California Governor Jerry Brown has signed a new law to shift California to 100% carbon-free electricity by 2045. Can you talk about the significance of this? And overall, we're here for the entire week broadcasting because of the Global Climate Action Summit that is taking place here, a kind of mini COP before the big, climate summit in Poland. The significance of this kind of activism, Professor Mann.
Yeah, thanks. And I couldn't be there for the conference because I'm teaching here back in Penn State University. But let me say in full disclosure that the governor, Jerry Brown, is a close friend of mine, and he's a hero of mine as well. He has really made climate change, addressing climate change, the central principle of his administration, of his governorship. And here now, thanks to the state legislature, which has written this very tough new climate bill, and the governor, who has now signed that bill, California is sending a signal to the rest of the world. Let's not forget, California is the fifth largest economy in the world. So when California speaks, people listen, governments listen, policymakers listen. And California has now sent a very strong signal. We're moving ahead. We want to be part of the solution. We realize that we can preserve the environment and grow our economy at the same time. And California is doing that. The rest of the world needs to get on board as well. Most of the rest of the world is. Many states in this country, like California, the West Coast states, the New England states, Virginia, New Jersey, are on board. But we have, again, at the highest level of our government, our presidential administration and congressional Republicans doing everything they can to block progress. We need to change that. And one way to change that, of course, is voting in elections.
Let me ask you, given that you're a good friend of, so have the ear of Governor Brown, we were at the major march this weekend, the largest one in the United States. It was here in San Francisco. Tens of thousands of people came out. And among the criticisms was his continued support for fracking. They called it a huge smear on Governor Brown's green record. Also, people like California's Californians Against Fracking said it's hypocritical for Brown to call himself a climate leader. If you could comment on this.
Yeah, so he's led in so many ways. And I think sometimes here there is the danger of the perfect being the enemy of the good. Perhaps one could argue there are some blind spots, in those policies. But Governor Brown has probably done more than any other governor in the country to advance action on climate change. And at a time when we have inaction on the part of our administration and on the part of the congressional Republican leadership, we need every ally we can find. And Jerry Brown has been a leader on this issue, and he continues to lead on this issue. And he does have our ear. And there is an opportunity to make some progress on the issue of natural gas and fracking. It's a problem here in Pennsylvania as well. We have an economy that is substantially driven by the natural gas industry. So these are tough issues to deal with. They do get sort of at the heart of the economies in many of our larger states. But we need to make progress on this issue as well. No question about that.
Mm-hmm. And finally, on this issue of climate change, your overall assessment of President Trump, what you would say to him right now, and the new EPA head, Andrew Wheeler, the former coal lobbyist who replaced the disgraced Scott Pruitt, who was forced out over so many corruption investigations.
Yeah, well, I would give him an F, but that would be unfair because that would imply that maybe he gets 60%, which is normally our cutoff for a failing grade. He actually gets 0%. He gets
negative percent
in the sense that Trump has taken us backward. He's actually done everything in his power to dismantle existing environmental protections, including the policy advances that were made under the previous administration, under the Obama administration, when it comes to fuel efficiency standards and the Clean Power Plan to cut our emissions from the power sector. All those things that Obama did to try to meet our obligations to the rest of the world. In keeping up our end of the Paris Accord. Of course, Trump has tried to undo all of that, and as you mentioned earlier, and now he's rolling back these key methane rules. I think it's probably fair to say that when it comes to the environment, Donald Trump is the worst president we have ever had. Past Republican presidents like Nixon, Reagan, both Bushes actually acted to support policies to protect the environment. Nixon created the EPA. George H.W. Bush created cap and trade to deal with the problem of acid rain. Ronald Reagan signed the Montreal Protocol to ban the chlorofluorocarbons that were destroying the ozone layer, these pollutants that were destroying the ozone layer. So it's actually unprecedented to have a president who is actually trying to take us backward rather than forward when it comes to acting on the greatest environmental threats we face. And to me, it's ironic because if you're a true conservative, you should want to conserve the environment, conserve the planet. And Trump is doing just the opposite. And that has dire implications for our children and grandchildren. Donald Trump may be the greatest threat that we face because of his policies that favor environmental destruction.
And finally, Michael Mann, although I said finally about four times right now, but there is nonstop coverage, as there should be, of this Category 4, possibly 5 hurricane that's barreling down on the Carolinas and Virginia, 1.5 million people being evacuated. And yet there is rarely a mention by these meteorologists when people are watching TV of the connection to climate change. This is when people are taking in the most information. Your thoughts on this, on the TV meteorologist coverage? I'm not talking about the specials that are occasionally done on a network, but the daily drumbeat coverage of these catastrophes, linking them to climate change.
Yeah, you know, there are some great meteorologists out there who are trying to connect the dots for the public. Rob Marciano of Good Morning America comes to mind. But too often, our meteorologists, our broadcast meteorologists, don't really connect the dots for the public when it comes to the role that climate change is playing here. And I think there are a number of reasons for that. One of them is just that it requires context. It requires explanation. And in a soundbite-driven media environment that we live in today, and the 24-hour news, the very rapid 24-hour news cycle, sometimes it's difficult to work that context into discussions of weather. What role is climate change playing with these extreme weather events? We actually did see some good coverage this summer in the wake of these unprecedented weather events, the California wildfires, unprecedented floods and heat waves and drought around the globe. In fact, we did see network news coverage where they were talking about the role that climate change was playing. But that was only after many of us complained about the lack of that context. They were listening to us, and there was eventually an opportunity to provide that. I hope that'll happen here. We're at the very beginning right now of the discussion of the news cycle that's going to be driven by Florence and its impacts. And so my hope is that we will, as the coverage proceeds, see that context, that network news programs will be inviting climate scientists like myself onto those programs to talk about these linkages, because it's a huge lost opportunity if we don't explain to the public the fact that much of the threat that we're seeing today when it comes to these unprecedented weather extremes is being caused by the aggravating effect of climate change. The public needs to understand that so they can force policymakers to act on this problem.
Michael Mann, I want to thank you for being with us. Distinguished professor and director of the Earth System Science Center, Penn State University. His latest book is titled The Madhouse Effect: How Climate Change Denial is Threatening Our Planet, Destroying Our Politics, and Driving Us Crazy. Coming up, President Trump's national security advisor attacking the International Criminal Court, saying they will not allow ICC judges into the United States, among other things. Stay with us.
Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky, stormy weather. Since my man and I ain't together, keeps raining all of the time. Oh yeah, life is bare. Just can't get my poor self together.
Okay.
So weary all.
By Etta James. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Trump's national security advisor, John Bolton, has threatened U.S. sanctions against International Criminal Court judges if they proceed with an investigation into alleged war crimes committed by U.S. troops in Afghanistan. In 2016, an ICC report accused the U.S. military of torturing at least 61 prisoners in Afghanistan during the ongoing war. The report also accused the CIA of subjecting at least 27 prisoners to torture, including rape, at CIA prison sites in Afghanistan, Poland, Romania, and Lithuania. John Bolton made the comments in a speech at the Federalist Society Monday.
Today, on the eve of September the 11th, I want to deliver a clear and unambiguous message on behalf of the President of the United States. The United States will use any means necessary to protect our citizens and those of our allies from unjust prosecution by this illegitimate court. We will not cooperate with the ICC. We will provide no assistance to the ICC, and we certainly will not join the ICC. We will let the ICC die on its own. After all, for all intents and purposes, the ICC is already dead to us.
John Bolton also threatened to directly target judges at the ICC.
We will respond against the ICC and its personnel to the extent permitted by U.S. law. We will ban its judges and prosecutors from entering the United States. We will sanction their funds in the U.S. financial system, and we will prosecute them in the U.S. criminal system. We will do the same for any company or state that assists an ICC investigation of Americans.
During his speech, John Bolton also announced the Trump administration would close the Palestine Liberation Organization's office in Washington in response to a Palestinian effort to push the ICC to investigate Israel for war crimes.
The Trump administration will not keep the office open when the Palestinians refuse to take steps to start direct and meaningful negotiations with Israel. The United States supports a direct and robust peace process, and we will not allow the ICC or any other organization to constrain Israel's right to self-defense.
Palestinian diplomat Saeb Erekat criticized the move.
We were notified officially that they would close the office and lower the Palestinian flag. And this is an affirmation of the U.S. Administration's determination to continue its policies of blackmail and extortion and undermining the peace process and the two-state solution. They have cut all humanitarian aid.
For more, we're joined by Jamil Dakwar, director of the American Civil Liberties Union's Human Rights Program. Jamil, welcome to Democracy Now! Can you talk about what John Bolton is saying, the significance of his Federalist Society speech yesterday on the sanctioning of the ICC, saying he will not allow ICC, International Criminal Court judges, into the United States because of they might be investigating the United States and Israel for possible war crimes?
You know, an unprecedented attack on the rule of law. This is unheard of, that you have a government and a country that has committed acts of torture in another country, and the country itself, the United States, failed to hold any official accountable for acts of torture by the CIA, by the U.S. military, during the armed conflict in Afghanistan. And that happened during the Bush years, and then Obama administration failed to take the comprehensive, thorough investigation into those acts and said, we will look forward, not backward. And now we're seeing a Trump administration doubling down on their assault on international law and human rights and impunity and the fighting impunity by saying, we will now go against the same body that is a last resort for victims of torture. That is the only international institution recognized as the one that is supposed to prosecute, investigate and prosecute war crimes, crimes against humanity and genocide. And the Trump administration is saying, we will be treating your judges and prosecutors like drug traffickers, like war criminals, instead of admitting that there was a failure in holding officials accountable. So John Bolton basically is the same John Bolton he was when he was in the Bush administration. He was the same one. He made destroying the court a lifetime project and goal. The difference now, he is in the place where he can do more than what he was doing in the Bush years. So this is a very dangerous attack on the international body that where 123 countries are member, many of them are close U.S. allies, particularly in Europe, that is supposed to defend the independence of this body. And yet we see John Bolton perhaps wants to score points with the political base, the people who are supporting Trump in the United States by invoking distorted and misinformation about the fact that the court is likely to investigate crimes that actually do not exist under the statute, under the law of the ICC. So we are in a very the tipping point where the administration is basically saying we are going to have a frontal attack on judges and prosecutors and personnel. By the way, there's no legal theory to support that. I don't understand what is it that, how is it that they will be prosecuting judges for the mere fact of conducting their job and responsibility under international treaty that is recognized again and ratified by 123 countries. What is also concerning and very dangerous is that the threat is not just against the judges and the prosecutors and the personnel of the court, but it's also against any state or party that is supposed to or willing to assist the ICC in its investigation of U.S. war crimes in Afghanistan, Lithuania, Romania, and Poland. These are the three countries where the CIA had black sites where people were tortured. And that means that they are opening, they're sending this threat to anyone, virtually anyone who would be in a position to assist the ICC. Does that include lawyers? Does that include individuals, organizations here in the United States, lawyers who represented torture victims, including us as the ACLU? Where does that go? What is it that the Trump administration wants to do? But ultimately, they're seeing that the ICC is about to open a full investigation into the into torture in Afghanistan. As the report said, that this investigation is not only against the United States. It's the United States and Afghan forces, Taliban forces, who are part of the armed conflict in Afghanistan. What makes it so important and significant here is that the United States is the country that has the longest tradition of upholding the rule of law and having an independent investigative bodies and judiciary to investigate acts of torture when they occur. And yet it failed to do so. That's why the ICC is stepping in. The ICC is not stepping in just for the sake of how Bolton put it, just to undermine U.S. sovereignty. This is really a nonsense. They are stepping in because we failed, the United States failed to uphold the rule of law. It failed to investigate acts of torture that were well documented by the Senate torture report that was published or at least partially declassified in December of 2014. So we're in a position where we see an escalation in attack on international bodies. This is the same administration that withdrew from the Human Rights Council. This is the same administration that is now changing the rules of engagement with regard to the use of targeted killings. This is the same administration that is pulling out of international treaties, including the issue of like the Paris Accord, which you talked about in the previous segment. So we're very concerned about that, but I think we also we need to put it into perspective. This is the same Trump administration that has a abysmal record on human rights here in the United States and is trying to encourage other countries to follow its pattern, the pattern of disregarding a court of law, the rule of law, disregarding international law, and basically saying that there are certain countries that are above international law, that they should enjoy immunity, should not be prosecuted or investigated. The United States, after all, is the one that actually conducted these operations, military operations, intelligence operations that were involving torture and prolonged detention of detainees in Afghanistan. And that's why I think we ought to step back and look at where is it, and not to buy into the false and misinformation that is being spread by John Bolton without no basis in U.S. law as to threaten prosecutors and judges and so forth.
Mm. And what about the U.S. closing the PLO's offices in Washington? In retaliation for them pushing for Israel to be investigated for war crimes in the occupied territories, Jamil?
It follows the same kind of argument. The administration is basically arguing that Israel has conducted, it has a very robust judicial system that would investigate war crimes in Gaza or the West Bank. We know from Human Rights Watch, from Amnesty International, from Israeli organizations like B'Tselem, Palestinian human rights organizations, that there were no full independent investigations into war crimes into Gaza. That's why the Palestinian was sought to justice before the ICC. It is because there was no recourse for victims. There was no recourse for people who were killed by bombings in Gaza, by other violations of international law. And that's been an ongoing for a long time, that they decided to take that step of seeking justice at international level. And yet now the administration is saying, the Trump administration is trying to use the Israeli case to as a way to shed, also to kind of protect itself from its own war crimes in Afghanistan, in other countries where the CIA had operated black sites. And I think that ultimately it's about whether this administration will be allowed to breach international law, to act as if it's a country that does not follow international law. When the United States wants to pursue use international law, it does so probably very effectively against its adversaries. When it comes to very close allies, it turns to give them a pass. It turns to say, no, the law doesn't apply here. They should not be recognized as a jurisdiction of the ICC just because it harms U.S. interest. I think that is an opportunity for us to talk about the United States, whether the United States is really fulfilling and playing a role that of a fair and really a true champion of human rights and upholding international law, while we see again and again examples where it is not doing that. It's actually going to protect those perpetrators of war crimes. What does that say about other situations of the ICC, for example, that are still pending? The ICC is not just has about 22 situations that are being, whether it's ongoing investigations or preliminary investigations, including places like Georgia, with the war between, or the armed conflict between Georgia and Russia. They just announced recently a preliminary investigation that will be in the Philippines and the war on drugs and the atrocities that are happening there. What is the message that the Trump administration is sending to those governments as far as the way that they should be treating the ICC, the judges and prosecutors, and whoever is assisting those ICC investigations? So this really goes to the core of fundamental principles of defending human rights and human dignity and fighting impunity.
And very quickly, Jamil, I wanted to get to UNRWA, the UN agency that supports Palestinian refugees in the occupied territories and beyond, 5 million people. The U.S. saying it's cutting off all funding.
Again, this goes to the pattern of what serves this administration's political agenda. Does it really serve the interest of U.S. interest, long-term U.S. interest? Does it really understand the consequences of cutting aid to hospitals in East Jerusalem that are operating, providing cancer treatment to Palestinians? Does it really help to close down the education institutions that helped educate refugees? The U.S. has been a long a supporter of many institutions that helped provide aid to refugees, including to UNRWA. And yet it is clearly part of that agenda of attacking refugees, attacking anything that is really standing in the way of Trump's agenda of and his political priorities, particularly when it comes to its alliance with Israel, when it comes to seeing refugees as enemies rather than people who deserve to seek asylum and refuge and safe haven. So I think that one have to be really wondering, where is the administration taking? What is the message that are being sent by shutting down aid and cutting aid to humanitarian organizations, by attacking the credibility and the legitimacy of an international court that is upholding international humanitarian law and international law more broadly, particularly in a time when we see that there's more and more war crimes, more and more crimes against humanity committed everywhere, and there is a need for accountability so that there will be a consequences for not just acts of torture, but you know, for much wider wider scale atrocities that we've seen in other places in the world. And yet, this administration is saying, following Trump's dangerous America First agenda, is trying to abandon. In some way, some good things that the United States did after Nuremberg, United States supported in the many of the international war crimes tribunals, that particularly in the 90s and leading to the establishment of the ICC. And I think that it's important for us here in America to understand why this matters, because the ICC, after all, is trying to help preserve humanity, is trying to fight impunity. And if the United States will become the enemy of this ICC court, people will have a different view of the United States, and it will have consequences for the United States and its relationship particularly with member states in Europe, where they have to abide by the international obligations under the ICC and to defend the ICC and to also cooperate with the ICC. That will be difficult for the ICC to conduct a thorough investigation if this investigation that is imminent to be authorized by the pretrial chamber. It will meet a lot of hurdles, but I think it's important to for us to understand that this attack is really unprecedented. It will only make it worse for any future where we can see accountability and justice, and we can see some sort of a deterrence against those governments that are trying to undermine international law and for the sake of their own nationalist or other kinds of interests that are similar to what Trump is trying to do here in the last couple
Jamil
of years.
Jamil Zikwar, I want to thank you very much for being with us, director of the American Civil Liberties Union's Human Rights Program, speaking to us in New York. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, tennis superstar Serena Williams calls out sexism in U.S. tennis. Stay with us.
Hit the ground, babe. It's all right now. Hit the ground, baby.
Hit the ground by Liz Wright. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. We end the show with sports and politics, an ongoing fallout from the Women's U.S. Open final Saturday, where tennis superstar Serena Williams lost to 20-year-old Naomi Osaka after accusing umpire Carlos Ramos of sexism. On Monday, the Women's Tennis Association came out in support of Williams, with Chief Executive Steve Simon suggesting the umpire showed a different level of tolerance to Williams because she's a woman. During the final, Ramos gave Williams a code violation after he deemed a gesture made towards her by her coach to be coaching, which is banned during a game. Ramos then penalized Williams a point after she destroyed her racket in anger and docked her an entire game after she subsequently called the umpire a liar and a thief for stealing her point. This is an exchange between Williams and Ramos.
Verbal abuse, game penalty, Mrs. Williams.
Williams' opponent, Naomi Osaka, who is of Haitian and Japanese descent, went on to win the match 6-2, 6-4 in her first Grand Slam victory. On Saturday, she became the first Japanese-born player to win a Grand Slam singles tournament. Speaking during a post-match news conference, Serena Williams said her treatment was different than how male tennis players are treated by umpires.
I can't sit here and say I wouldn't say he's a thief because I thought he took a game from me, but I've seen other men call other umpires several things, and I'm here fighting for women's rights and for women's equality and for all kinds of stuff. And for me to say thief and for him to take a game, it made me feel like it was a sexist remark. I mean, like, how he's never took a game from a man because they said thief.
The tournament.
It blows my mind.
The tournament referee's office later fined Williams $17,000 for the incident during the match. Well, for more, we go to Penn State University, where we're joined by Amira Rose Davis, assistant professor of history and women's gender and sexuality studies, co-host of the sports podcast Burn It All Down. Her forthcoming book, Can't Eat a Medal, The Lives and Labors of Black Women Athletes in the Age of Jim Crow. Welcome to Democracy Now! Can you start off by talking about just what happened? I mean, how rare is this in this extremely white sport of tennis? You have two black women on the finals court. You've got a Spanish umpire, and they're playing in Arthur Ashe Stadium. And look at this controversy with Serena Williams calling out sexism in U.S. tennis. Amira.
Yeah, it was a real mess. It's the second straight year we've had two black women in the final, and certainly being on Arthur Ashe gives it a certain significance. But I think one of the things here that we've seen is that this conversation about sexism in tennis keeps coming up. Just 2 weeks ago, again, we were talking about Serena's catsuit ban, and we were talking about Elise Cornette's warning for taking off her shirt. And so I think that that's one of the reasons why all of this came to bear on this match. Now, when I watched it, I thought, oh, what a mess, because not only was, you know, it very hard for Serena to navigate this situation, but it really overshadowed dominant and impressive play by Naomi Osaka.
I mean, and that's also really important, Professor Davis, this issue of who Naomi Osaka is, who ends up crying when she's presented with her trophy and people are booing. And yet you have Serena Williams, who is then hugging her, understanding exactly what this meant, this moment that you've been such a victory for Naomi, who said Serena Williams is the reason she's in tennis, is she's so inspired by her. Two black women kind of pitted against each other.
Precisely. And I think one of the things that has happened in the wake of this is there's been a move in certain media headlines to paint Naomi Osaka as against Serena in some way. There's a particularly vile, racist, and sexist cartoon in the Herald Sun that depicts Serena Williams as a kind of oversized, full-lipped, reminiscent of a caricature drawing of African-Americans in the Jim Crow era, throwing a tantrum. And Naomi Osaka is in the background, and she has very long blonde hair, and it's almost like she's been whitened, whitewashed. And I think that we can't lose fact of this point. One of the reasons that Naomi Osaka was so emotional, and as she said after the match, is she's a Serena fan, and she wants Serena to win. And so she has to get out of that mindset in order to compete with her. But she said, when Serena held me and embraced at the net, it was like I was a kid again, and I was her big fan. And I think that that's such a strong point. Her father, who's Haitian, got her into the sport after watching the Williams sisters and watching Richard Williams create opportunities for his black child in tennis. And he mimicked that blueprint to get Naomi into the game. And so very much this is part and parcel of the same thing. Naomi Osaka is not against Serena. In fact, one of the things that Serena is advocating for to really look at the box that is placed around women athletes in terms of what emotions they can express and how tennis matches are adjudicated, that is to the benefit of players like Naomi Osaka and future players to come.
And just to correct, the umpire Ramos is Portuguese. And finally, the featuring of Serena Williams in Colin Kaepernick's video, the video of Colin Kaepernick, the Nike video that has come out as the NFL opens, and he is not signed to any team, but he's talking about African-American women like Serena Williams, who are, you know, the leaders in sports, breaking every record.
Precisely. I mean, I think that that's a huge point. While the conversation has really veered towards sexism in tennis, it's really about Serena as a black woman that has prompted such a visceral reaction from many black women, because Serena symbolizes the feelings of a lot of black women in this country whose bodies are scrutinized, whose parameters for expression seem to be pretty tightened, who have dominated, who are, you know, the best at their craft and seemingly still are relegated outsiders to their profession. And so I think that one of the reasons that the reaction was so visceral to this moment is that a lot of people identified with Serena Williams and the struggle that she's manifesting, which is not to say that it was the frustration. It was rather the fact that who's allowed to be frustrated, who's allowed to have outbursts. And as Serena cited, and as many male players on the circuit have come out in defense of her and saying, I've said far worse things, and I have more leeway on that, on that end. And so I think one of the reasons why we can tie this
Professor
to
Davis, we have to end it here, but we're doing part two. We're doing part two at democracynow.org. Check web exclusives. Professor Amira Rose Davis. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.